This is the Old Town Hall. 16 South Road, it now houses both the Historical Society main office and Bedford TV, along with the Great Room on the top floor. This is Don Corey, who is the former president?
Former president, former chair, board chair.
Yep. Of the Historical Society.
A little background about Old Town Hall and then about the Historical Society. When the Town Hall was built in 1856, it was intended both for town meeting business, which was all done up on the top floor, and it was the central school. And this area in the middle floor of Old Town Hall was the center school for the town of Bedford. There was also a north school, east school, south school, west school, but the kids here came here. In 1891, the Union School was built, which is what's now the town, the recreation and town center, and all the kids moved over there. And at that point, this place that had been the school became the library. And when you come in the main entrance, which the room over here became the police chief's office. And when we go down to the ground floor, they put jail cells down in the bottom floor. So the top floor was used for meetings, but also social events back then, concerts, and when the movies came, then they'd have movies up there. So it was social as well as a meeting place. And after 1891, when the center school was built, then this became the library, police. And in the 1950s, both the library moved to a new library space, and the police moved to where the fire station is now. So the Historical Society was created by the library trustees in 1893. And so the Historical Society basically was a part of the library when it was meeting here in the early days. Back in about the 1950s, when the library moved into its new offices, which is now the police station, the Historical Society stayed there. The library, meanwhile, outgrew that place and moved into the current library, and the Historical Society stayed in that building since then until 2 years ago. And the police came in, and the Historical Society continued to stay there along with the police. But now the town has approved moving the offices and the archives of the Historical Society down on the ground floor of this building. And there's also efforts now to make a museum in the third floor while just maintaining it, the capability of having it for social events and for public meetings and all. So the use of the building is evolved a lot. In the meantime, the Historical Society has done a lot to try to improve awareness of a lot of historical treasures, resources around the town. One of the first things that the Historical Society did back in 1893 after it was founded was to go out the Two Brothers Rocks out on the Concord River, and I'm sure a lot of people are familiar with them, but those were the markers where Governor Winthrop and Lieutenant Governor Dudley were given huge land grants, 1,500 acres each. About each one was about a quarter of the size of the whole town of Bedford, and the Brothers Rocks mark their respective tracts. The Governor Winthrop ran south from the rocks, Dudley north, and the Historical Society engraved on the two rocks which one was which rock. And so people now can recognize those aren't just huge glacial boulders, those had historic significance. And they're well documented in the Massachusetts historical records and in Governor Winthrop's journals. And we like to say these are the oldest documented natural objects, because Plymouth Rock, which claims to be the oldest one, was based on hearsay two generations later that some kid said his grandfather said that that's where they landed. So we feel that this is well documented. But in the meantime, Historical Society has done a lot to recognize other things, and it's also collected a huge amount of historic records and artifacts. One of the oldest documents that we have was one after Governor Winthrop, his grandson inherited his huge 1,500 acre tract of land. Joe Blaine bought that land and established, he was one of the first settlers in Bedford, and we have the original document of Joe Blaine and Governor Winthrop's grandson conveying that land. So this goes back to the 1643, I think. It's very old, very fragile. Some of the other things that we have, a lot of people know about the Shawsheen witch. Supposedly, when Benjamin Fitch, who ran the Fitch Mill on the Shawsheen River, married his wife, came to town, and she was branded as a witch. Her mother had testified at the witch trials and all, and she was wearing a red cape, and everybody shunned her. But then there was a disease supposedly spread through the town, with a lot of kids very ill, some died, and she took care of them. And after that, the story of the Shawsheen witch was redeemed. Well, the red cape has been handed down through generations from the Benjamin Fitch's wife, and we have that. And whether the story about the Shawsheen witch is true or not, we have this red cape, which is 300 years old. It's probably the oldest clothing article that we or anybody else around here, probably even Concord, has. So we've gotten some really old stuff. We have a lot of revolutionary stuff, a lot of Civil War stuff, and a lot of the more recent municipal business, but also private businesses and things associated with every phase of Bedford's history. So it's a good collection. It was displayed in a museum up until the 1990s, when the police station had to take over that building. But we're all the archives, we hope to be able to get out and get a lot more stuff back out where people can see it and appreciate all of the interesting history that Bedford has. So I think we'll take a look at that, I think, after this, and you can get an idea, a feel for some of the stuff we have. So,
yeah. So I have a couple of questions.
Sure.
So what museum was the Red Cape in?
The Red Cape was handed down in the family of the descendants of Benjamin Fitch and his wife, and it was given to the Historical Society and was probably displayed in the museum. The building that's now the police station, there was a museum on the bottom floor of that building, and it was probably displayed there for a short time after the family had donated the cape to the Historical Society. Since then, it's been kept in the archives, but on a number of occasions when there have been one day or weekend shows, we brought it out. And when the school department used to have Walk of Bedford every spring with a third grade or fifth grade, we'd always have that out for the kids to see, and the story that goes along with the Shawsheen witch. So hopefully we'll be able to put it out on a more permanent basis, but it was out for a while when still had a museum up until the mid-1990s, and now it's only brought out when we have an opportunity.
Yeah, so when did the police station move out of this building?
The police and fire moved into what is the current fire station in the early 1950s, 1952, 1953, and the library moved into the building that's now the police station, also in about 1955. So the mid-50s is when all of those people moved out, and then this just became town offices for a number of years. However, the building has had a lot of work done to it. The building was closed up and not occupied for the late 1980s, 1990s, early 2000, because there was no handicapped access to this building, and there were a lot of other things that didn't meet the building code. So the administrative offices had moved out of here, and they'd moved into other spaces, the current town hall, and they had also spaces in the what's now the police station. But the historical town historic preservation commission, which I'm also on, worked with town manager then Rick Reed and the Mass Historical Commission, and we've got a series of grants, so we were able to restore the town hall and to do a lot of improvements for current building code, so that the floor loading on the top floor will accommodate the number of people it can fit, which it didn't used to do, and a lot of soundproofing. And there were some other buildings. There would have been a brick vault built on the side of the building, and that was just removed during the renovation. And in 2004, the building was rededicated in the form that you see now. But it was for about 15 years before that, it was in quite rocky shape, and it was not occupied because of the problems with the building code and handicapped access.
Yeah, so as the former chair or former president, what have you experienced? What good experiences have you had at the Historical Society?
Oh, I think that this has a very significant historic part of Bedford, and working to save the building. There was an effort by the select board in the 1990s to get rid of the building, to sell it, and somebody that probably would have wound up destroying it. But between the two hats, the Historical Society and the Historic Preservation Commission, the Historical Society really wanted to save it, and Historic Preservation Commission is a town commission. We were able to work with the state Mass Historical Commission in order to actually get grants, and the town had to match those grants in order to physically do the recovery that everybody really wanted to see done. Because once we were able to display that there was interest at the state level in saving the building, then a lot more people got on board. And we also had gotten it to a certain point before the state passed the Community Preservation Act. And as soon as the state passed the Community Preservation Act, Bedford was the first town to accept the Community Preservation Act. This is one where there's a surcharge on property taxes, but then the money has to be used for open space, affordable housing, historic preservation, and all. Well, Bedford was the first town to accept that Community Preservation Act, and restoration of this building was the first project. So that's how important people thought that was.
Do you want to go take a look at the archives?
Sure, we can do that now.
The Davis family was one of the early families that settled here in the 1660s. They donated this highboy, which we have displayed here. The Historical Society also owns their 16-spinning wheel, and that is on display out at the Joe Blaine House. We have quite a few of our things also out on display there, household articles, artifacts from back in the period when the Joe Blaine House would have been first occupied, and that type of furniture and furnishings and kitchenware and furniture. So we're going to go into the storage area now. We're in the storage area now, and we have shelving along one wall that holds an enormous amount of documentation going, I'd say, back to the Joe Blaine 1660s deed up to fairly modern things. We keep copies of modern town reports and things too. This is a sample of cobbler's bench, cordwainer's bench, back in the early 1800s. All the shoes were handmade, and a couple of people started a handmade shoe industry in Bedford that just took off. There were several hundred families in Bedford that were making shoe components, and then they were combined into shoes and sold in the Boston market. And in one of the peak years, say, Bedford was making 90,000 pairs of shoes that were going into the Boston market. But this is one of the benches that would have been used by one of the people who was making them here. Other artifacts that we have here, most of are boxed up. A few of them are too big to fit in. This is a cream separator. We have quite an extensive dairy collection from both farms where they had the dairy cows, but also the dairies, the Prescott Dairy, Blue Ribbon Dairy, and Bedford Farms Dairy. And this is a type of cream separator that first came up after people were just gravity separating cream from the milk. The raw milk would go into the bowl on top, and then this would be cranked very easily, and it would, centrifugal force would separate the cream, and so the cream would come out one of these spouts, and the milk, after the cream had been removed, would come out to the other spout, and so you would collect those separately. And of course the butter, the cream would be used to make butter, ice cream, that sort of thing. Now, the rest of the collection is boxed up, but this is too big to go. This is another sample of things too big to store. We have a lot of musical instruments and history of things and photographs of Bedford musical instruments. Bedford had a series of Bedford bands, marching bands, and this is a drum from one of those marching bands. This one was 1933 band. And we've got Glockenspiel from a Girl Scouts collection, I believe, and ancient clarinet, ancient violin. Violin, I believe, goes back to 1720. And so a lot of very old stuff, but most of it is boxed up, and these are all photographs and pictures that will be mounted once we get the museum reestablished, and they'll be put in. We're going to move on to a mini museum display we have. This is a diorama made by one of the former Bedford Minutemen of the Bloody Angle nearby where Captain Jonathan Wilson of the Bedford Minutemen was killed. And it's a ambitious work that Ralph Hayes had put together in order to do that. This side is a modern Bedford Minuteman uniform donated by Stephen Tutko, who was the captain of the Minutemen back during the town's, during the bicentennial, national bicentennial. Samuel Stearns was the town's minister. There was only one minister at the meeting house. And Samuel Stearns, from the late 1800s, the late 1700s until 1830s, was the town's minister. And this was his desk, and he wrote his sermons and all standing at this desk, not the way we do nowadays. This is a picture of it back when it was fully, when the shelving was fully utilized. This is a World War I Army uniform. We have a number of military uniforms. These are a couple of interesting women's dresses, and we have dozens of this type of clothing that we've donated to the Historical Society over the years. A lot of interesting things. This is just a desk that came from the shoe factory where a lot of the components that have been built, but that have been assembled in shoes, components but in homes. They put things together at the Chamberlain Building factory, and then those are the ones that were shipped out. And so this is a desk that came from there. And then we have display cases of a few things that are out for on display. Some of the revolutionary objects are right here. And these shelves, and these are unique geological rocks that are found in Bedford, but elsewhere as well. But these are a type of collection, and these are old household articles that had been donated to the society. Now back in the late 1800s, mid to late 1800s, early 1900s, Bedford Springs was a big resort area on Springs Road, just north of where the VA hospital is now. And there was a carriage track all the way around Fawn Lake, where they had carriages for resort people coming up there by train and or by electric trolley. And they also had a steamboat on Fawn Lake. After Bedford Springs closed, everything was demolished. And in recent years, DPW discovered things that were thrown into Fawn Lake. This is extremely heavy, but it's a cast iron unit that was set along the carriage trail so that people could try their horses up and get out and do whatever they wanted to do. But it was a hitching post for horses, both of these. This one was broken off. And so those are interesting relics from the Bedford Springs era, the hitching posts. And these are other things that came from the hotel there, Sweetwater Hotel. That was the log book. And the person who owned all this, Dr. Hayden, also had a New York pharmaceutical company located there. And the pharmaceutical company, the picture of the pharmacy is there. It's now condominiums. It was restored and it's now condominiums. But these are some of the products that he was making back in those days. So those are some of the things, a small introduction of the things that we have, but most of them are boxed up and waiting to find their way back out to where people can enjoy them. So, thank you.
Yeah. So I had one more question.
Sure.
So I've heard that like during the Revolutionary War, George Washington actually came to this exact building and asked for like a public restroom and stuff. I was wondering if that's true.
I'm sure it's not true.
I
no.
heard it. I was like, I don't think that's true.
We don't have any documentation that he actually was in Bedford. No. So, nice try, but we'd hope we have. No, he was here in Boston in 1775 when they drove the British out of Boston. It's sort of unique because we had, you know, 4th of July is July 4th, 1776. March 17th, St. Patrick's Day, also happens to be Evacuation Day, which is a Suffolk County holiday. That was the day the British left Massachusetts for good. And Massachusetts was independent of British months before the Declaration of Independence was even issued. But Washington was down in Boston and Cambridge, so I'm afraid we can't take any more credit than that.